morning is obviously when we have competition. So make sure you guys sign up for a slot of when you want to present. Otherwise, we're just going to randomly fit you in. And that's definitely subject to change. What's not is your order. So if you put in down an order, if you put down first, you'll be the first team to go. But if you put last, you might not be at, you know, 2:30 or something. It might get moved up based on how many teams are still presenting at that time. I don't suspect any of you guys to drop because you guys are here now. But in the past, we've had around a 40% drop rate from teams in the last couple weeks. So we have 17 teams right now, including in the both tracks, 13 in the undergraduate and 4 in the graduate program. But there's a likelihood that teams will drop. So the time is going to get moved up based on that, if that makes sense. So just be on the lookout for when you're presenting, but be ready to be there all day. And again, if you have any conflicts with that, let me know. A few other things I wanted to highlight and let you guys just really make sure you guys know is that I want to remind you guys that the written plan is only 30% of your final score. So the final score of how the judges score your overall plan, presentation, everything, only 30% of your score comes from the written document. So while that written document is a pretty significant thing that you're turning in, 70% is going to come from your presentation on presentation day. So it's really good that you guys are here looking, just listening to some tips right now and getting started on your pitch, because that definitely shouldn't be an afterthought. That should be something you really practice with your group, by yourself, and that you just know your stuff. So those are my biggest things on that. But if you guys have any questions on the rules, let me know. But those are some of the things I really wanted to highlight before we got started. And like I said before, just make sure you guys have everything signed. So come take a look at this stuff before you leave. Pick up extra copies if you need it. So let's get started. So the first thing I wanted to talk about is we have these awesome postcards that we're sending out to alumni and other people involved in Concordia to invite them to the competition, just to build for the mixer and the competition day, which is to get a lot of people there. But if you guys want to take however many of these, we have tons of these, if you guys want to take these and send them to family, friends, whatever, feel free to take these. We have lots of them. So if you guys want to do that, that'd be great. Just so you can have, you know, it's like a little invite that you can send out to people for sure. And then I'll have Alex, do you mind handing these out, pitch deck outline? So this is what we're going to talk about tonight. We're going to get into our presentation, the workshop on how to give a presentation effectively. The first thing we'll go over is the pitch deck outline, which is what Alex is passing out. The first thing on there is your introduction. And this is pretty much at this point, this is looking at the outline of the business plan document. And you're really just, you want to highlight these things you already put in your document. So if you've done the business plan document effectively and you're confident with the information in there, a lot of the information is going to go into your presentation one way or another. Now obviously you're not going to just copy and paste paragraphs of text into your pitch, because that would be boring and you're never going to be wanting to just read out the slide. A lot of your information is going to come from your document. If you've done your research and things like that, they're just going to go right into the pitch, if that makes sense. But backtracking a little bit, going to the introduction. You want to make sure that you start off strong. So that's, you talk about the team. Talk about the team just like you did in the document. So highlight your members. If there's just one of you, talk about yourself. If you have other people on your board that aren't students, that are a part of your company, whether officially or unofficially, you might want to highlight that just to show that you have some experience or some other people that are involved in your business and know what they're doing as well as you. And then obviously introduce your company. I know this might sound like a duh type of thing, but make sure you really introduce your company, because a lot of presentations, they just kind of start and they get right into it with what their product is or what they want to do without really introducing what the big picture ideas of their company, right? You guys know it, but no one else does. These judges are not the same judges that scored your written plan either. So they've never seen your business plan document. So your business plan document could be really good, really bad. They don't know anything before you get up there and present. So don't assume they read over your whole document, because they haven't. We don't give that ahead of time because we want to eliminate bias. We just want them to see your presentation and judge you and score you based on that, if that makes sense. So make sure you really, really introduce your company. Say, this is how we started, these are our thoughts, like all that. Really just make it a story. Start out from the beginning and just go with that. And then obviously going into our next section of marketing, we want to talk about your product, the industry analysis, customer analysis, competitive analysis, and marketing plan. These are all things in your business plan document. And now with these, I want you to make sure that you pick out things that you are confident in. Your presentation is your, you take your creative freedom with this, right? You might not be super strong in finances, so talk a lot about marketing. You might not be as strong with marketing, so talk a lot about your finances if you're stronger in that. Which leads me to the next slide here, right? You want to talk about, have these things in your presentation, whether or not they're on a slide or you're just talking about them. Make sure you're thinking about putting these in when you're preparing your presentation. And then the ask is a big one. You are presenting this to these judges as they are would-be investors. I realize I didn't get to your question either today. Hmm. You still have it?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, do you want to go? I'm sorry.
It's fine. What time is the mixer on Friday?
Okay, so yeah, backtracking, sorry. The mixer is at 5. The ask is super important because you are presenting to the judges as if they are would-be investors, right? So these are people who are looking and scoring your pitch as if they would give you money at the end of this. Maybe they will, maybe they won't. It's not they're not for sure giving money, but they could meet with you afterwards and say, hey, I really like you, I like your idea, let's talk. I have people I know, I have a lot of resources, let's see where this goes, right? That's happened in the past, and that can for sure happen in the future. And that's where they're coming from. That's what we tell them to do, and that's what we tell them to judge you on. So they're going to be very, very particular in terms of what you're asking for and what your company is, and they're going to be looking for a lot of these things. So you want to be asking these things. You want to be thinking about these things. How much money do we need to get started up? And they'd say, we need $30,000, and we will do that for 5% of the business or whatever that may be. So that's kind of like the Shark Tank style thing that we kind of model this after, right? And now, if you guys don't have any questions, I'm going to get into kind of how a pitch deck should look like and what the essentials are for that. So do you guys kind of have any questions based upon that yet? I know I just answered yours, Joy, from a while ago. You guys good? Okay. Let's get going with this then. Okay, so these are kind of 12 slides of a pitch deck. This is actually something I found online that I thought was very useful, so I'm going to be talking about this based upon how this is the how to give a pitch deck to investors and really just a good how-to guide that you guys can follow. So first of all is your introduction, which I kind of talked about with the plan. You guys already have that. You gotta talk about who you are, why you're here, and introduce yourselves, right? It's obvious, but just make sure you do that. Why are you doing this? Do you have a passion for the industry you're in? If you don't, you probably shouldn't be up there, right? Like you have to know what you're doing and love it, okay? And make sure they know that. But don't ramble on about that forever. You wanna make sure that your words are concise and to the point. Talk about your team, like I was saying earlier, that's another essential part. You need to know, the judges need to know who's in your team and what their role is. You can't both be doing the same things if they're just a team of two. You gotta split it up a little bit and divide roles and really realize who's who, right? So maybe someone's kind of heading your financials, they're your CFO. Someone's in charge of marketing, they're your CMO. Use these terms and look up these terms if you guys aren't super familiar with them, but use these terms effectively to show that you guys are a leadership team and that you, whether it's one person or together, that you guys are putting these skills together and you're comprising your company, right? Third is the problem. This is where you're gonna go start talking about the business. The problem, what problem are you trying to solve? It has to be a problem. It can't be a made-up problem like in a fantasy world, right? It has to be something that solves a problem today. Like McKinley, you were just talking about you want to put more kind of healthy food in vending machines. That's an actual problem that is addressed. You didn't just make it up, right? You noticed something, and this is your fix, and this is your company. That's what it does. That's perfect. That's what you would say. You kind of open with that, right? It's not made up. Advantages. So what makes your solution special? This is like the USP. A USP is a unique selling proposition, right? Is what sets your company apart from other companies. What do you do better? What are your unique aspects of your business? You want to highlight that because they're going to look for how you stand out from other people, because you have to realize that you're not the only one doing this. As revolutionary as you think you might be with starting a new business, there's other people that do things like you, okay? I mean, it's a very, very, very rare opportunity if you just completely disrupt an entire industry by being the first one to do something. So you have to know what other people are like in your industry and how you are set apart from that. You want to explain that, because otherwise that's going to be one of the first things they ask you at the end in the Q&A part, which is a huge part of this presentation, is why are you guys special? Why are you guys different than any other company out there who does in your industry, that they might say, right? And then talking about a solution, you have to, this is kind of where you get into the more specifics of how your product is going to bring a benefit to someone's life, how it's going to be a solution to that problem, as you're stating before. Again, getting into the product, what it does, and then traction. Traction means having a measurable, if you guys can't read that, I'll just read it here. It means having a measurable set of customers that serves to prove a potential. What that means is that you have a certain amount of customers who are your target customers. You need to know that. You need to know that there are certain customers and certain people who are more likely to buy your product or service than others, if that makes sense. Which kind of leads into market. Who's your target market? And how is that going to influence how you sell and who you sell to? If your target market is like stay-at-home moms, how are you going to target them, right? You would want to have your products or something in like Walmart or Target or places they shop. You want to have ads on maybe Facebook because that's maybe more popular with people in their mid-30s or something. Like, you want to think about where your market is and how to get to them. Obviously, talk about your competition. Like I was saying earlier, you're not going to be the only person doing what you're trying to do. Your business model, that says, how are you planning to make money? Show a schedule when you expect it. Revenues to pour in. This is when you're talking about your financials, right? You gotta be realistic with your numbers, but also forecasting ahead towards your future plans, right? So you really gotta think about that and really gotta be able to present that well from your written information that's in your business plan document. Investing, this is kind of like the ask, right? This is how much money you have. This is the ask, right? This is how much money you have, how much money you're gonna be spending, and then what you're looking for in terms of future investment. And then contact, if you guys want to put that up there, that's kind of on you guys. If you want to put like a website or your guys's like Instagram links or whatever, if you want to put phone numbers, emails, and if you want to do that, you can. I wouldn't necessarily recommend that. That would definitely be like your closing slide if you wanted to put that on like your thank you slide. But realistically, you're going to be following up with these judges in person after the event, talking to them. Then. So you don't. That's not a huge one, but it does kind of remind you to make sure you get in contact with them. You guys have any questions on this before I move on? Yeah, sure.
Can you send this to us?
Yes, I would definitely send this to you guys. Okay, so some of these. Now I'm going to get into some of the do's and don'ts on giving your pitch deck, because you guys have the information, you're putting it into a presentation. Now, these are things to think about when you're giving a presentation. And I'm sure if you guys have given any presentation in class, you're going to have thought about some of these already. So some of these may be a refresher, but some of these are definitely good to consider and just to know. So first, tell a story and engage people emotionally. This is huge. The graduate team that won last year, I think we've talked about her a lot, but she gave the most incredible story and background. And the judges fell in love with that, right? She didn't have the most experience in marketing, finance, whatever, but she told a story that the judges were able to get behind, the audience was able to get behind, everyone really fell in love with it, right? And if you are able to tell a story, no matter what you're selling, no matter if you're selling computer software or you're selling like a revolutionary breakthrough, like awesome, fun idea, right? It doesn't matter how fun you think your idea is, you have to be able to tell a story that people can relate to and want to listen to and want to root for you, right? Second, limit each slide to expressing one idea. This is really getting into specifics of giving your presentation, is that you don't want your ideas all over the place. You need to have be a point, a point, a point at a time. You can't be jumping all over the place. You need your slides to be have a visual, have some text that goes exactly with what you're talking about. You need to be on point with exactly what your slide is. You need to know where you are in the presentation. You need to be able to follow that well. And we'll get into more of this next week in terms of how kind of the layout of the room is going to be and how you guys can kind of expect for like day of preparations. That's kind of what like our Bring It All Together workshop is you guys asking questions like more logistical things and stuff, last minute kind of things like that. But looking ahead, you guys are going to be on the stage in the CU Center, if you guys kind of can envision that. And you guys will have the slides behind you that everyone's going to be able to see. You'll have a TV in front of you that you'll kind of be able to see, but it's going to be far away. And then hopefully we'll be able to put a monitor on stage right in front of you that you'll be able to look at. And if all else fails, you can kind of read off that without having to squint in the back or turn around. But you have a lot of these points of contact that you'll be able to see the slide that you're on, and you just have to know what slide you're on. And with that, you should be able to have a clicker that you'll be able to click through, so you won't have to like say next, next, next. You'll be able to control the slides. But again, we'll talk about that stuff next week. Making a good first impression, right? Your first 2 to 3 minutes of the presentation are key to setting the stage for the rest of your presentation. If you are not strong in the beginning, no one's going to listen to you through the end, right? You really got to start strong and lead that all the way through. So your confidence, the information you're delivering, your beginning is crucial to the rest of it. And I really think that if you start off strong, that confidence that you have already had from speaking will carry on through your presentation. So if you are really, really prepared in the beginning, even if you're less prepared in the end, which I don't suggest, that confidence will bring you through that, and you'll be able to get through your less preparedness, I guess, if that makes sense, right? So definitely start off strong and you'll end strong. In terms of a timeline, Alex, remind me on this, but we're shooting for 10 to 12 minutes per presentation.
Yes.
Okay.
We might end up capping off at 10.
Yeah.
So just work with that. It depends on how many teams. If we keep a lot of teams, around 15 teams, we're probably going to have to drop it down a little. If a lot of teams end up dropping out because they don't want to participate or for whatever reasons,
mm-hmm.
we may keep it at 12. Our
yeah.
goal is to try to have all the presentations done within about 3 hours, but that depends, of course, on how many teams we want to go.
Definitely.
And that's 10 minutes of the uninterrupted, that doesn't include
yeah.
question time.
Correct.
Right?
Q&A will be afterwards. That's going to be 5 minutes afterwards that the judges can ask me any questions they want.
That's going to be a huge part of it, too, is preparing for questions. You don't only prepare for your presentation, prepare for questions, right? So if we do cap it off at 10, which I think is more than enough time for you to deliver a concise, but also clear enough speech of your presentation, those 5 minutes, the judges will address anything that they think you missed. So you have to prepare for things like that. Things that you're like, I have no idea what this is, and you're thinking that in the back of your mind, and you're maybe not touching on that, you have to be prepared to give an answer. So for example, if a judge says, do you think you'll be making money by your second year? And you honestly don't know. You have to be like, we've looked through our numbers, we've been forecasting as much as possible, but we honestly don't know, and we'd love to have some more input on this from a financial advisor in the future. Thank you for your question, that was a great question, and I'd love to talk to you afterwards if you have more questions on that. You have to give an answer like that. You can't just say, I don't know. You have to be able to say something that, even if you don't know, you still give an answer that shows that you've thought about it and that you need to find outside help in the future if you're going on with this business. Yeah, Alex?
Also, don't lie. Do not say,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, sure. We've got these great things and we're planning on making this much money, because then they'll say, oh, how much? Or prove it.
Yeah.
And then
they'll call
you're
out
really
for
smart.
Sure. Yeah.
Because they'll call you out on stage.
Yeah, these are smart people. They know what they're talking about. So make sure you're being honest with yourselves and them, because they'll know if you're just BSing right through it. This is, again, show the people behind your idea. I kind of already talked about this. Highlight your team members. Highlight your guys' successes personally, even without the business. Like, if you guys have relevant experience outside your business, highlight that. That's huge. It shows why you're up there and why you're qualified. This is huge. I really believe in this, is when you're giving a presentation, it should look professional. It shouldn't look sloppy. There shouldn't be typos. There shouldn't be anything that distracts from your presentation. Your visuals should only add to what you're saying. And you should be able to give this without a pitch deck. You You should be able to talk about your idea without a pitch deck, but what your pitch deck does is it keeps you on track and it provides some visuals for the audience. And in that sense, if you have a logo, your logo should go on every single slide. If you have a certain color theme or something like that, that should be on every single slide. So think through these things and make sure you give a good, clean, consistent look that is throughout your whole presentation. And that goes on to say, too, that animations and transitions are not even necessary, they're unprofessional. So in the sense of getting a pitch deck, you don't need those things. While it's kind of fun to do that for a class and in high school and stuff, you don't really need that, and you shouldn't have that. You should just have one slide to the next, focus on the content and how everything looks once the slide is up there, not the transition in between slides. This is huge, and this is where it goes back to the things you don't know. You have to be able to give an answer for that and how you're going to figure that out in the future. But you need to know your metrics, and you need to know the numbers. If the judge asks you numbers that you know are written in your plan but you don't know, you're not going to be flipping through your plan the day of. You should be able to know enough of your business that if they ask you one of these questions, you can provide it to them, if that makes sense. So that's most of the do's, and now we're going into some don'ts. Again, stop me if you guys have any questions, but I'm going to kind of just breeze through these as well. Alex, I'm going to do it on time.
Excellent.
What is it?
32.
Okay.
Excellent.
Cool. Don't use too many bullet points. Make sure that each slide is not too wordy. You want to limit the amount of information to one slide. Like I said earlier, speaking with one idea, that one idea shouldn't have too many bullet points. You should be saying most of the things that are on your slide. If you guys are noticing, like, even the presentation I'm giving right now, right? I read maybe the header, but then I'm talking about everything else, and I'm not just reading the slides, right? It's boring if, and you guys have had teachers, I'm sure, that just read a PowerPoint, or even like when you've seen a presentation in class, they just read it. They just say this: limit the bullets. Too many bullet points will kill a presentation. And then like there's four more lines, and they just read that. They don't look at you all. They don't elaborate. They just say that, and then they go to the next slide. That's boring. You need to make eye contact. You need to talk about, embellish upon the bullet points. Embellish upon your topics that are on the slides, and talk further on that, right? You're able to talk to someone in a meaningful setting if you're able to look at them and communicate your ideas and not just look at the screen and they're just reading along with you. That's boring. They have to look at you and listen to you if it's not on the slides. If you're, what you're saying is not all written down on the slides. And don't make it too long, right? Like this says, an average entrepreneurial pitch is 38 slides. No one's going to be wanting to look at a pitch deck that is so, so long, right? You're not going to be putting a slide up there that you're talking about for, I would say, less than 10 seconds at a time. And if you have all those slides, it's either that it either looks like you're breezing through your presentation, or you're going to be spending so much time on all these slides and you're never going to get done in time. It's just going to drag on and on and on. You want to make it as minimal as possible without leaving out information, right? So this kind of 12-step guide is a good thing to look for. I would shoot for anywhere from 8 to 12 slides total. And if you guys go under time too, you're not going to be penalized for that. If you have a 10-minute time limit and you go 8.5 minutes, there's nothing wrong with that. The Q&A will just start right after that, right after you guys are done. I have to say thank you for listening. People will applaud, yay. The judges will have a microphone, and they'll start asking questions. So don't worry about going under. But if you go over time, you're going to get cut off. Your microphone's getting muted or something, and you're just going to get cut off. So make sure you practice that, and that you're under time, not over time. Because that's another thing, too. Whenever you practice, your practice is usually always shorter than what it is. Because when you get up there, you might mess up a little bit. You might add a little bit on, embellish a little bit more. It's always going to be a little longer than you practice. So if you practice in like 10 minutes, perfect. No. Take down a little bit and make sure you really, really give yourself wiggle room there. Like I was saying earlier, right? You're not just reading word by word by word. You got to make eye contact. You got to embellish on the ideas that are there. Don't create a text-rich, picture-poor presentation. This is another big thing too, right? You don't want just too much text, but on the other side of it, you don't want just too much pictures and no text. If you have a slide deck full of pictures with no text, you have no context which to build up what you're saying. So you have to find the middle ground there, right? Where you can give people good pictures to look at, but also have some text explaining what's going on. Don't come unprepared. This goes well with you guys need to practice beforehand. That means the week that you're, ideally you make your pitch deck by like kind of over the weekend and you have it kind of done early in the week so that you can spend a week preparing or a couple days preparing where you're able to kind of prepare with your group, by yourself, whatever it may be, maybe 30 minutes a day or something. You prepare kind of 30 minutes a day, run through your presentation, maybe, you know, three times or something a day, and you're able to do that. You start maybe with some notes, maybe with looking at some things. By the end of it, you're not looking at any of that, right? Using note cards, it's not, you're not, we're not going to say you can't use note cards, but if you do, you're going to be at a disadvantage in terms of how the judges are perceiving you. So if you have to look at a note card real quick to look at some information and remember a number, that's fine as like a all else fails type thing, but don't rely on your note cards fully, if that makes sense. And we'll get into that next week, and it might even be better. We might even say really don't use them. So don't plan on using them. Practice enough so that you don't have to use note cards. Your slides should be kind of your notes. You see something on the slide, and you're like, oh, that's right, and you go into it. Don't use small fonts. Make sure everything can be right on screen. I hope that you guys, if you guys haven't, go into CU Center and look at the screens, right? Look at where people would be sitting from, and look at how, I mean, I'm kind of even out of using a poor example of this, right? Some of you guys can't really read this. I mean, that's because there's bad light in here, and it's kind of like a light text and whatnot. But the screens in the CU Center have improved since last year, which is really good. They got new projectors in there, new screens, so everything is a lot brighter. So as long as your pictures and everything is big enough, it should be legible. But keep in mind, too, that something that looks good on a TV screen or on a computer screen is going to look a lot lighter than it looks like on there. So like if I flip this around to you guys, it's a lot darker on a computer screen. It's a lot lighter on a presentation screen. So remember that when you guys are thinking about making a presentation with different colors and what looks good, keep that in mind when it's going to go up onto a projector. Right? It's going to look a little different. And then some last kind of notes that I just wrote down, just remembering from last year's competition and just in general. Remember to just be humble. Don't boast about your business, but be proud. So there's a you can really still be proud and humble at the same time, right? Those things don't contradict themselves. Where it's contradictory is if you go up there thinking you're a know-it-all and that you are the most intelligent person in the room. You might know the most about your industry, and then, but still, the judges and other people are going to be able to know more than you in different areas that you think that you're good. So just kind of know that. Be confident, be proud of what you're doing, but don't act boastful, right? Don't brag. And then using Google Slides. This is the medium that we use for all the presentations. So when you're making your presentation, I highly recommend using Google Slides so that when you convert it, it doesn't get all messed up. And that's how you'll send it to us. So just send it to us in Google Slides. It's going to go in a huge Google Slides document, and that's how it's going to get presented on. But yeah, that's pretty much it. So that's everything I have for you guys. If you guys have any questions, this would definitely be the time for it. If you guys want me to kind of look at your pitch decks or even going back and looking at some business plan document things, if you have questions for that, now's the time. So thanks for listening, guys.